Welcome to the second tutorial on deep learning in neuroscience. Recall Ottoliva's discussion of convolutions in the introduction. Convolutional neural networks with several layers revolutionized the deep learning field, and in particular, AlexNet, depicted here, was the first neural network to excel on the ImageNet classification task. The first layer in the network takes as input an image. It runs convolutional filters on the image, rectifies the output, and then downsamples the output with this pooling layer. The next layers repeat this process, and then at the end, fully connected layers, linear layers like the ones we looked at in tutorial one, are attached, which output a label for the image. The main advantages of convolutional layers over fully connected layers are the reduction in parameters through weight sharing, which we will get into shortly, and also the fact that these units have local receptive fields. These local receptive fields allow the network to pool over units in spatial proximity and help the network learn translation and variant representations. All right, so what is a 2D convolution? So the convolution is the integral of the product of two functions, one of which is a stimulus and the other of which is a filter. And so we have two sets of dimensions here. So our stimuli are height by width, and then our filters are size k by k. And so we're going to take our stimulus and we're going to slide our weights across our stimulus. And so here's an animation of this procedure. So that you can see the weights in gray sliding across the stimulus in blue, creating this output in green. And so at each of these positions, the filter is multiplied by the stimulus in that box and added together to create the output, which is each one of these boxes here. So one thing to note, if you want to perform a convolution and get the same output size as the input size, you need to pad the input by half the filter size on each side. And we do this here. You can see this padding here. And in this case, the filter size is k by k, and k is 3. So our k divided by 2 is 1 here, and so we pad by 1. And another parameter of the convolution computation is the stride, so how often the convolution is computed along the stimulus dimension. In this case, we used a stride of 1. We're sampling every single position here, but we can increase the stride and in turn have fewer output units. So all of the units of this filter here are the output channel of this convolutional operation. And a convolutional layer usually consists of multiple channels, so we might have, this is our first channel. We might have another set of weights, which creates this channel output, another set of weights, which creates another output channel. So we have, and this, we could have many, many channels here. So we have many output channels that are created from many sets of weights. And this parameter C out is the number of output convolutional channels we have. And so within your group, you should discuss how many weights does this conv layer have with C out number of convolutional channels. Similarly, you should discuss if this were a fully connected linear layer, how many parameters would this layer have? And you should find that the number of parameters you need for a fully connected linear layer is much more than for a convolutional layer. All right, so how are we going to implement this in PyTorch? So we're going to create this convolutional layer using nn.module again, like we did in tutorial one, and we're going to create this initialization function, which takes a few different parameters as input. First is cin, which is the number of input channels. In this case, that's 1 because we're using grayscale images of gratings. And in practice, you'll often have 3 input channels if you're using red, green, blue images, for instance, from the real world. We'll also set the C out, the number of output convolutional channels, to 6. And then we'll set the kernel size or the filter size K to 7. And then we'll also have an optional input, which is the which are some pre-designed filters, which we'll use to try to better understand the convolution operation. So let's create our convolutional layer. We're going to create self.conv as a nn.conv2d variable, And this takes as input C in, C out, the kernel size, the padding and the stride. And we're going to set it so that we get the same, the padding and the stride, so that we get the same size output as we do, as we have input. And then we're going to set the filters. We're going to set the weights of our conv layer to these filters that we're inputting. And then we're going to set the bias terms to zero for each of these convolutional channels. And then we need to declare one more piece here, which is our forward step. So remember from last tutorial too, you have this init method here, and then you also have this forward method you need to declare for your neural networks. And so this forward method takes as input the stimulus S, and then it puts the stimulus into our convolutional layer and returns this output A, which is going to be number of stimuli by number of output convolutional channels by height by width. And so what are some example filters we might use? So in this tutorial, we're going to use center surround filters. These are going to be, it could be positive in the middle and negative in the surround, or the opposite. And we'll also use Gabor filters, which have a positive section next to the negative section, and this can be rotated. And both of these filter types are in fact inspired by neurons that have been recorded in the brain. So let's apply these filters and see what we get. So let's take this image here. And if we apply a center surround filter to this image, what you'll find is it is positive when actually there's kind of edges in the image. And you can think with your group why a filter like this might create an output like this. And then for this Gabor filter, sort of output you get applied to this image looks like this. Again, we're getting edges, but there's in fact an orientation dependence. So for instance, this line here is not actually activating this filter here. This output is not positive or negative because it's not oriented in the same way as the Gabor filter, this line here that was actually activating the center surround filter, but it's not activating the Gabor filter there. So in the exercise, you'll get several outputs and you'll have to guess sort of which filter is creating which output. All right, so in fact, I said previously those filters were inspired by neuroscience, and in fact, convolutional layers in general were inspired by neuroscience. So in the retina, there are a variety of cell types which we can think of as these different filters, and each of these cells tiles the entire visual space. So you can see in this picture, this shows the part of visual space that each one of these cells corresponds to. And then similarly in barrel cortex of mice, this corresponds to the area of the brain that activates when whiskers are moved or hit objects. There's this similarly parallel structure where each whisker activates a certain part of barrel cortex, and there's thought to be similar filters in each of these different barrels. And so in the next bonus exercise, we'll implement and fit a convolutional encoding model directly to neural responses, because we think the brain is in fact convolutional as well. Just like they inspired convolutional layers, we think they'll be helpful to also help us understand the brain.